Anand, what is MCP? It seems to be like all over the place now, like a lot of people talking about it, but what is it actually?
Yeah, so if you think about agent-to-agent communications, if you think about setting up a, let's take a concrete example, right? So let's say I'm building an AI assistant where the assistant can get asked any question. And let's pick an example. Let's say I'm an airline chatbot and my passengers can ask any kind of questions about their experience with the airline. Now, some questions might be about how do I do something on the website? Like how do I book a ticket? It's like a documentation question. Some questions might be about my flight got canceled. I need to book a new ticket. Can you help me with that? Right. So depending upon the use case, what you can do with an MCP server now is you can register different kinds of tools. So MCP is Model Context Protocol. So you can register different tools with it. So one tool might be call the database, get some information back to me. Another tool might be, in fact, an agent that can go and execute a particular task for me. Okay, find out the next available flight that goes from this city to that city that this passenger can travel on. Right. So so it is an easy way for you to build applications where the server kind of abstracts away a lot of the information that your application needs to know about what capabilities are available in the product you're trying to connect to. And it kind of figures it out. So it takes a prompt and it figures out, okay, what's the right set of tools I need to call to get the job done? So at a high level, that's what MCP does.
How's it different to an API?
So an API, think of that as a more static deterministic thing. The caller needs to know exactly what is the task that the API can accomplish. And they need to know that, okay, if the API spec has 1,000 APIs, I need to call API 501 for this particular task. But at the MCP server abstracts away a lot of that. You can express the intent, and based on the intent, it knows what tool to call.
So you can have like an LLM talking to an LLM. Is that kind of right?
Exactly.
Whereas with an API, you have to like write a Python script with very specific stuff. Is that right?
Exactly.
And so the power of this is that you can use an AI, you can integrate an AI into your product.
Yes. So the whole game in the future is around how quickly can you go from a user intent to getting a job done. So previously, a user intent needs to be expressed in a UI through a bunch of button clicks, through a bunch of form fills, right? And then in the backend, whatever code that you had is going to call the backend with the right set of APIs, with the right set of data filled in to accomplish the particular task the user was trying to accomplish. Today, with Gen AI, what we are doing is a user intent is expressed in natural language. It comes to an MCP server, and that knows exactly the combination of tools to call to accomplish that intent. So essentially, we are transforming user experience with a whole new interface, if you will, that is completely natural language powered.
Big concern a lot of people have, and same, I think, for a lot of us, is security. I mean, if you let these agents just go for it, I mean, bad things could happen.
Yeah. So this, it's a rapidly evolving space. And I would say it falls into a few categories, right? So the first category, when you think about models, is model scanning. Just like we did virus total and file scanning in the past, how do you do that for models? How do you know that a model you're downloading from a model marketplace on the cloud is safe? There's no malicious links. There is no malware. So that's the first part of it. The second part of the lifecycle is within an organization is asset visibility. Do I know all the models that are being deployed in my environment?
Yep.
Are they approved? Have they gone through the responsible AI clearance within the organization from a compliance perspective, right? The next part of that is what we call model validation. And that's a really interesting part, right? When you think about traditional software, and if I'm an engineer and I came to you and said, David, I've built this software and I'm ready to take it to production, you kind of know all the steps you need to do from a pen testing perspective and everything else to take it to production. But what does that mean for a model? How do you red team a model? How do you make sure that you've identified all the possible vulnerabilities you know? More importantly, how do you know what are the compensating controls you need to have in place as guardrails so that the model is safe to be deployed? So that's the model validation phase. The next step is the runtime protection of the model. So going back to the airline chatbot, so I built a chatbot, now I launched it in AWS. How do I make sure that when a customer interacts with it, if they put in their passport number, you can prevent it from being shown to the customer support agent?
Yeah.
But more importantly, if an attacker, and I ask the model, hey, show me all the pricing data you were trained on, that the model doesn't leak pricing data, right? So that's the runtime protection part. And the last part of this is how it integrates into enterprise workflows, right? And even though companies might send out emails to employees to not put source code into ChatGPT, there might be employees that might do that. Now, if they do that, and you have an AI security product like our AI defense product that that detects that, how do you trigger an enterprise workflow from ServiceNow or any product that you have that now sends an email to that employee? By the way, you are in violation of this policy. Watch this security awareness video. We all love watching our security awareness videos, but you have those enterprise governance workflows, right? So that's the model development lifecycle. Now, the same set of things need to be built for MCP and MCP security, for agents and agent security. But the visibility, detection, and protection as the three categories of the lifecycle still remain the same. Just the approach changes, right? If you think about more broadly, there's three kinds of entities that interact with AI in an organization. There's humans, there's devices and workloads, and there is agents.
Yeah.
For humans, for example, at Cisco, we have something like Duo. For devices and workloads, we have something like Identity Services Engine, and customers might have other products. And for agents, we have something like AI Defense. Customers might have other products. Now, the question becomes, when you think about identity of these entities, how do you stitch all of that together into an identity intelligence that knows how an agent inherits its privileges, which human created it, what data can the agent access, where is that data sitting? These are all very, very topical things that organizations need to think deeply about before they take a lot of these products to production.
I love that. And I love that Cisco have got products to help big companies because, I mean, it's confidential data. If that's trained in AI, I mean, so hacker's paradise if they can get access to that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'll give you a real example. So let's say I'm a pharma company. I have a lot of really interesting proprietary data and I'm researching a molecule to cure cancer. Pick a cancer that all of us care about. And I'm building a proprietary model for that. I don't want that model to be in the public cloud. I may not consider it to be safe enough. So we are seeing a really interesting trend of sovereign AI, sovereign data, bringing AI back into the data center. So if I'm that pharma company, I want to run these models on-prem, on my infrastructure. So what does it mean for the world in terms of new AI-ready data centers that are being built? What does that mean for having training data closer to your data center versus sitting in the cloud? Organizations are going through a lot of reimagining of their cloud strategy to more of a hybrid strategy in terms of where they should be investing their dollars, where their training workload should be there. They might want to do dev work in the cloud, but some of this really confidential stuff they might want to do in their own proprietary data centers, right? So we are seeing a real reimagining of this. So if you look at what Jensen and NVIDIA are talking about, if you look at what Chuck and we are talking about at Cisco, a lot of fascinating work is happening in the data center.